Hi friends, welcome to the course on Leadership for India Inc. offered through NPTEL platform. We are in week 1, Introduction to Leadership. This particular lecture, lecture number 5 in week 1, covers management thought in part 3. We have so far considered several thought leaders who propounded many thoughts relating to general management, corporate strategy, business strategy, organizational behavior, individual psychology, and such similar topics. We also looked at scientific management as propounded by Gilbreths as well as Frederick Taylor. We also looked at project management, other techniques which were brought in by Gantt. Now we will look at more contemporary management thought leaders. Of course, I have interspersed them with some of the foundational management thought leaders as well. We hear and read a lot about strategy. There is so much written about general management and general leadership. However, not much is written about execution. Probably it is because execution is considered everybody's job and everyday's job. We have here Ram Charan, who has done some work on execution in a path-breaking manner. He teamed up with Larry Bossidy, who was a senior leader of General Electric, and authored a book called Execution, The Discipline of Getting Things Done. He is one of the chief consultants for top honchos in corporations, and he focuses on goal-driven execution. His culture of execution has got 7 components: people and business, realism, goals and priorities, follow-through of plans, rewarding execution, expanding competencies, and finally, knowing oneself. According to Ram Charan, the ability to follow plans and get things accomplished is a discipline. Execution is a discipline, according to him, that can be learned just like any other. Leaders need to lead for execution, and they should not delegate execution, he avers. And he feels that execution should be engraved in corporate culture. That's Ram Charan for us. We also have one of the famous leadership coaches. As you know, coaching is extremely important because it develops very visible, positive role models. He is a pioneer in the use of 360-degree feedback and one-on-one leadership coaching. He has written a book which is very thought-provoking. He says, "What got you here won't get you there," which is a truism in corporate and business world. So he says, at the top of major organizations, even a small positive change in behavior can have a very big impact. From an organizational perspective, the fact that the executive is trying to change leadership behavior and is serving as a role model for personal development may be even more important than what the executive is trying to change. His leadership coaching process has 9 steps. It starts with identifying the desired behavior, identifying key stakeholders, collecting the feedback, reviewing and developing the action plan, not only with the person who is being coached, but also with his superiors and also along with the key stakeholders. Agree on key behaviors for change, develop follow-up process, review results and start again, and end coaching when results are achieved. I have personally seen coaching work, and coaching is extremely important when senior leaders transit from one industry to another or from one national culture to another national culture. As a head of a subsidiary of a global multinational corporation, I had the opportunity to coach several leaders who were finding it rather difficult to adjust to the new culture that India represented. So coaching is an extremely important aspect, and we have Marshall Goldsmith coming out with several frameworks which are useful for mentoring and coaching. Subir Chaudhary is a new age author who is focused on quality. He had earlier authored a book on Six Sigma, and it was his own experience that Six Sigma, when applied as a very rigorous statistical methodology or an operational methodology, companies which implement Six Sigma are a few ones only. He came up with a follow-up book called The Power of LEO, Listen, Enrich and Optimize, to make it applicable in a much easier manner. He is advocated in his LEO model that leadership has the central responsibility for quality. It has the ability to utilize tools like Six Sigma, and it has the accountability to make quality an integral part of culture. He said that problems are bound to be there, and they are supposed to occur at a current pace. But it is the responsibility of the leadership to imagine a future state and then solve the problems utilizing the quality tools that are available. As we know, out of several leaders whom we have considered, 60 plus, only 3 to 5 were focused on quality. So it is very important that we accord equal importance to people who are passionate about quality and who write about quality and follow the total quality management systems and other quality improvement methodologies that they suggest. Quality is core and central to corporate success. We have Stu Friedman. He has a total leadership approach. He is from Wharton School of Business and he was responsible for writing a book called Total Leadership. What that framework says is that there are 3 clusters in which leadership can be looked at. Most of these factors, these 9 factors which are there in these 3 clusters, deal with the leadership personality. The first cluster looks at work, family and community, that is firm related. The second cluster looks at the self, the mind, body and the spirit. The third cluster looks at values, authenticity, integrity and creativity. So this framework looks at leadership personality from 3 aligned prisms. The strength of the leader's personality in terms of these 3 important clusters, with accountability to internal stakeholders as well as external stakeholders, and also with accountability to one's own values and to one's own mind, body and spirit, is actually the foundation of the ESG leadership model, which I talked about in the earlier lecture, because ESG is driven by a positive personality of a leader. Another important thought leader is Roger Martin. He brought in the concept of the design thinking for business. He said that generally thinking can be classified in 2 ways. 1, analytical thinking, which is based on hard facts and data and trying to develop relationships, trying to develop focus based on analytical thinking. The other is intuitive thinking, that is ability to creatively think based on a perception which comes from deep insight as to what could happen in future. So he says that analytical thinking and intuitive thinking need to be balanced by a leader, and that is accomplished through design thinking. When you design think to identify a problem and solve for the problem, you start with a base of mystery. You don't know what you needed to solve, but based on your studies, you develop a heuristic, which you then try to make into an algorithm of developing a product or a service. Then you codify the entire product development system and you try to technology transfer it, place it into the manufacturing board and ensure that the productivity of developing the product becomes helpful for the firm as well as the customer, and the costs drop as a result. So the design thinking, which starts with a mysterious starting point, ends up in developing a product which provides a good experience and low cost to the customer. He is a top influential thinker of modern business. Then we have got Rosabeth Mascanter. She has developed an integrated innovation management system for corporations. She has written a book based on her study of 3M, DuPont, GE, Pfizer and Rubbermaid. And she has talked about innovation management in those companies, and she has developed certain formulae for embedding innovation in the companies. What she says is that people tend to make strategy mistakes where hurdles are very high and scope to go forward is too narrow. And she comes up with a remedy, saying that you widen the search for options, broaden the scope of strategic search so that you get at the solutions which are probably more suited for your firm. Secondly, we tend to make process mistakes. That is, you get controlled by the bureaucracy and the rigor of the processes we have put in place. And the remedy for that is to have flexibility so that the planning and control systems are adaptive and flexible to the developments that take place. The third series of mistakes are structure-related mistakes, which are either close fit, too tight connections, or too loose connections between departments, between the company and the customers, and between leaders. And the remedy she suggests is to facilitate close connection between innovators and mainstream businesses, because innovation is as important as mainstream, and every department, whether it is operational department or a futuristic department, they need to work together. And finally, the skills mistakes, wherein leadership is found to be too weak and communication too poor. And the skills remedy is to select for appropriate leadership and interpersonal skills, surround the innovators in the organization with the supportive culture of collaboration. Again, you can recall the three concentric circle model, where we talked about the individual being at the core and center, enveloped by the boss, and finally the firm and the ecosystem. Therefore, skills can be developed if you have a helpful ecosystem. And her proposal is that once these four types of mistakes are remedied, it will lead to widening of the search for new ideas. It makes the controls less tight and more flexible, and structures more adaptive. It forges better connections between innovators and mainstream operations, and cultivates good communication and collaboration skills. So the quest for innovation, according to her, requires managers who seek to learn from the past but always look towards the future. They should get the right balance between exploiting, which is getting the highest returns from the current activities, and exploring, that is trying to develop new ideas, new products, and investing for new developments in the organization and for the customers. It requires in some organizational flexibility with a great deal of attention to relationships. At another end of spectrum, we have Anil Gupta, who says that one should listen to as many people as possible for you to get grassroots innovations developed into a corporate mainstream. He believes that many stakeholders are capable of providing ideas, providing innovative solutions to the problems we find. He is a visiting faculty professor at the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, and he is also a member of the governing body at our Indian National Innovation Foundation. So he has written a book on grassroots innovation. He says that one should keep the eyes and ears open always for new ideas and acute problems, build platforms of innovation, institutionalize strategies for innovation, and most importantly, to inspire people, document and celebrate the stories of innovators, and so on. And at the end of it, you should aim to embrace not only jugaad, but also embrace frugality as a way of doing things. As a result, you will also promote microventure finance. He says that diversity of thoughts and diversity of skills and people is the essence of inclusiveness and creativity. Quantity as well as quality of innovative ideas are very important. And according to him, long-term experience and the legacy of the past experiences should not come in the way of encouraging younger people come up with newer ideas, and new perspectives can be developed, he says, by seeing, observing, abstracting, labeling, clustering, understanding and assimilating from what various people say and what we as people observe in the marketplace as well as the industrial canvas. Another management leader is Han Wang. She has talked about the realities of India and China. She is probably one of the first authors who has served to focus the global mindset on the emerging huge markets of India and China. She says that these two markets are mega markets, have platforms that dramatically reduce companies' global cost structure, have platforms which will boost a company's global technology and innovation base, and are springboards for the emergence of new fearsome global competitors. Today we see what China has done and what India is very likely to do. And in collaboration with Professor Anil K. Gupta, she has also written the first strategic guide for MNCs wishing to India, because entering India is not easy. We have our own culture, we have our own capabilities, and we have our own ways of doing things. But all of these things are driven by a passion for growth. and we would like to do things which many people have taken many years to do, but we would like now to do things with a great degree of self-reliance on one hand and also globalization on the other hand. So her book is a nice treatise on how to get into emerging markets such as India and China, and in doing so it breaks new grounds of thought how multinationals can benefit from India and China. Anil K. Gupta supplements these kinds of thoughts with his own evolutionary framework of globalization. He wrote about the quest for global dominance. He says that there have been four phases of globalization. Globalization 1.0 started when entities such as the British East India Company went global in the search for markets outside their home country, that is United Kingdom, and then for raw materials. Globalization 2.0 began around 1980s when manufacturers in the United States and other developed countries began outsourcing work to Asian countries. Globalization 3.0 commenced when research and development began to be globalized. Companies such as IBM, Microsoft, GE, Mercedes-Benz and others built R&D centers globally. And globalization 4.0 now is fueled by the ubiquitous and rapid spread of digital technologies cutting across all sectors and segments of industry and economy. His view of globalization is a bit different, as you can see. It is not based on equipment made. It doesn't say that industry 1.0 is based on certain type of machinery, industry 2.0 is based on other types of machinery. No, it is more based on the actual transnational movement of market seeking, production seeking or cost leveraging activities, and finally today innovation led globalization and digitalized network globalization. So he believes that globalization 4.0 is going to be far more pervasive than any other previous tranche of globalization, and it would affect, permeate and transform all of the three globalizations that have occurred, and they still remain as the globalization trends, and there would be a total transformation in the nature of ties between and across countries. Eric Ries, he is one of the foremost thinkers and writers about the entrepreneurial systems. He has written the book on startups, The Lean Startup, which has provided an account of how startups can start lean and make themselves very efficient in the entrepreneurial journey. But what is important is that he has also propounded ways and methodologies for large corporations to be entrepreneurial. In fact, he has developed an entrepreneurial management system which has the following five episodes. 1. Continuous innovation. 2. Atomic unit of work. 3. Entrepreneurship as a function. 4. Entrepreneurship as a second founding for the company. A second founding, because we are talking about established companies. So if they want to take a rebirth as entrepreneurially oriented companies, they need to look at entrepreneurship as the new driver of growth. And then continuous transformation to rewrite companies' DNA. While Eric Ries, the Startup Way and the Lean Startup focus on startups, the second book, The Startup Way, really demonstrates a great way for embedding entrepreneurial thinking in large corporations and in corporate environments. So it is very useful and pathbreaking in terms of marrying entrepreneurship with the professional running of established companies. We have got Yves Egner, who has been a Belgian computer scientist, professor of management and information systems. He has developed a concept of the invincible company, that is an company which cannot be easily conquered. And the recipe for invincibility lies in the four factors: business portfolio map, innovation matrix, culture map, and business model mechanics. He says that all disruptors and senior leaders should have the best available tools and methodologies so that they can have from day one a culture of innovation and a methodology for managing innovation based product portfolios and setting up corresponding organizational structures. So if you look back on whatever we have discussed during this session, you will find that innovation has been one of the flag bearers of thought for the new generation of management thinkers. Steve Blank, He is a Silicon Valley entrepreneur who has been sharing his knowledge and experience on setting up entrepreneurial firms. And he has been a professor in several universities, and he has a course which is called Lean Launchpad Class at Stanford, Columbia and UC Berkeley. It has changed the way entrepreneurship is taught because it is very much hands-on, and it brings into togetherness several aspects of higher education ecosystem, corporate ecosystem, startup ecosystem, institutional ecosystem and adult learning ecosystem into developing something which is related to entrepreneurs. And he also taps the US market for venture capital financing or equity financing to ensure that all of these ecosystems are well funded. And he has developed a map called Petal Diagram, which connects these institutional frameworks with the funding frameworks. And he has also developed a four-step process to develop lean startups. Richard D'Avini is another management thought leader who was one of the first authors to speak about hyper-competition. Hyper-competition is one of quick change. It is almost like thinking of super fast moving consumer goods companies, which need to be very agile, very productive, very lean and efficient, but at the same time very versatile and very innovative in bringing the products to the market. So the drivers of hyper competition for him are the customer changes, including fragmentation of tastes, rapid technological changes, falling geography and industry boundaries as markets globalize, and deep pockets among competitors which fund continuous investment programs for multinational management. In his book, which is another book of his, on strategic capitalism, the new economic strategy for winning the capitalist Cold War, he talks about the differences between American way of capitalism and the Chinese form of capitalism, and how the Chinese system of capitalism has flipped many of the American advantages into disadvantages, and by that process succeeding through a combination of rigid autocracy as well as flexible capitalism suited for discipline as well as development in the Chinese methodology. And he also speculates how America could respond to these kinds of new risks on the business horizon. Getting back into the past, now we have Egon Ansoff. He is really a pioneer in strategic management thought. The product market grid we talk about in strategic management literature is attributable to his pioneering thoughts. He said that products and services can be classified as existing and new. Similarly, the markets can be classified as existing markets and new markets. The Ansoff matrix says that every company has to be in one of the four quadrants. If you are having new products and services and serving the existing markets, you are going to do product development. If you are having existing products and services and still remain with existing markets, you are doing market penetration. That is, you are trying to increase your share. If you are having new markets for your existing products and services, you are developing the markets. That is, you are enlarging the pie and taking a share of the pie and driving your volumes, revenue and profits. On the other hand, if you develop new products and services and capture new markets, you are going to do product market diversification. So this is the strategic roadmap, diversification roadmap for any company. It is possible for a company to utilize all of these planks somewhat sequentially as well as simultaneously to get the maximum impact in terms of corporate growth. One could leverage the existing products and existing markets sharper. One could develop new products for the existing markets, develop new markets for the existing products, and develop completely new products and markets, as all of these could be simultaneous ongoing paradigms for a company to expand aggressively. And that is the essence of Ansoff's strategy matrix for growth. Edward D. Bono, everybody who has some interest in self-help approaches knows Edward D. Bono. He came up with pioneering thoughts about six thinking hats. He believes that we cannot think about issues, whether they are problems or solutions or process, in one regimented thought process methodology. You have to wear different hats for different situations. So he came up with six thinking hats. The white hat calls for information known or needed. It is fact-based. That is very analytical. You also need to have an yellow hat, which symbolizes brightness and optimism. You need to be a leader who radiates positivity and hope for the future. The black hat is one of the core points of leadership, that is being objectively judgmental. You could be the devil's advocate or you could be the highest level of optimism, but you should finally make some judgments based on apparent dangers or real dangers, perceived difficulties or real difficulties. And one of the issues with this black hat is that given its dependence on analysis prior to judgment, it could be misused. So it is important to use black hat along with the other hats prudently. The red hat is the emotional hat. It talks about feelings, hunches, intuition. When you use that hat as a leader, you learn to love people, you learn to like and respect people, and you also learn to grapple with your biases and dislikes. The green hat, again taking the innovation cue, focuses on creativity. It looks at all possibilities, avenues for diversification, avenues for growth. It is an opportunity and platform to express new concepts and new perceptions. And the blue hat is a sort of integrating hat. It tries to manage the entire thinking process. It is a control mechanism that ensures that the six thinking hats are following the guidelines which he has stipulated. He recommends parallel thinking and lateral thinking as drivers for building individual, team and organizational capabilities. I would say that six thinking hats is a great methodology for creative solution making for problems which are not easily solved. Again, from the self-help grouping, we have Dale Carnegie. His book has been praised as the life manual in the self-help classics, How to Win Friends and Influence People. He has focused on the importance of interpersonal relationships and having positive human relations and positive individual relations. So he said that before you expect something from the other person, you must change your own behavior. You should try to understand others better, the point of view, where he is coming from. Become a more likable person, improve relationships. Win others over to your point of view based on understanding their perspectives and improving your own perspectives. And only through this process, you can influence behavior through leadership that has all of these elements. While this is not a classic management thinking, it is certainly a way of thinking that has profoundly altered how individuals look at each other in small groups, large groups, or how companies also can look at other companies in terms of understanding each other. It is relevant for contemporary thinking even today. Albert Mehrabian comes up with a totally different approach to leadership communication. He says that we think we have communicated enough by speaking a lot. It could be so even in my case. I'm thinking that I'm communicating through the audiovisual platform. However, there are certain limitations to how I can communicate. I'm in one particular place and you are in a distant place. But if you really look at small group communication, you'll find, as he has really postulated, that most of our communication is verbal, but it actually is in terms of impact 7%. About 38% of the impact in terms of liking comes through the tone of communication, which is the nonverbal state of communication, and the body language, which comes through nonverbal body cues and gestures. They determine the dominant form of communication. When you have town hall meetings, if the entire group is very silent, you will get certain feedback saying that yes, they are extremely compliant to the dot, or they are just passive. You need to understand, by encouraging feedback and understanding the tone of the feedback, the gestures of the team members or even the peers who are next to you, whether the communication is going the way you would need to look at. So for effective and meaningful communication about emotions, these three parts of message need to support each other. That is, they have to be congruent. The verbal message, the tonality of your message, and the body language of the message, they need to be aligned and congruent to make the maximal impact in terms of communication efficacy. Otherwise, there could be divergent cues that come from the communication platform. Warren Bennis is considered the father of leadership. He has written a path-breaking book on becoming a leader. He says that a leader has five essential traits. He provides direction and meaning to followers. He conveys hope and optimism for the future. He generates and sustains the trust of his followers. He shares and engages with followers on a common platform of values and vision. And finally, he demonstrates results. When we go into the theories of leadership, you will find that many of these factors are ingrained in some of the leadership theories. What Warren Bennis says has got some nice insight. He says, no leader sets out to be a leader. We all live our lives. But in trying to live our lives, we are trying to become what we are capable of becoming. And once we become fully capable of what we are becoming, then we get into the leadership mode. Therefore, he says, the point is to become yourself and to use yourself completely, all your skills, gifts, and energies, so that your vision can be manifest in many ways. You must withhold nothing. You must, in sum, become the person you started out to be and to enjoy the process of becoming. Again, I will connect this thought process to the self-actualization thought process I talked about at the end of my session. You discover your innate competencies, develop those competencies better, set your aspirations high, accomplish those aspirations, and finally become what you are capable of becoming. So that's the essence of leadership, which is expressed in a similar fashion by Warren Bennis. Herman Simon, he is the founder and chairman of a famous consulting company, Simon Kucher & Partners Consultants. He has come up with a very contrarian viewpoint. Generally, the theory is that pursuit of high market share leads to high profits. It's called PIMS theory, profit impact of market share. But what he has proposed is the antithesis of PIMS. He says pursuit of market share, that too high market share, destroys additional profit potential. He hypothesized that companies can extract profit potential of 1 to 3 basis points by pursuing a profit rather than market share orientation. Why does he say so? He says that in mature markets which are characterized by exhausted scope, that is scope which is already fulfilled for cost savings and hard to get breakthrough innovations, we have to depend on marketing mix rather than pursuit of sheer market share. So you should differentiate mature products. Where necessary, you should take pricing action. Where necessary, you need to do promotional activities and understand consumer preferences better. It is not cost leadership that will gain you market share but erode your profit, but rather deploying the marketing mix judiciously and creatively so that the available products are better leveraged and made more viable so that your profitability increases. So his focus is on product viability and profitability rather than market share and contextual use of marketing mix so that there could be sustainable growth for firms. Obviously, what he is suggesting is highly suitable for established companies trying to grow the revenues and profits in times of competition. Linda Hill, she has come up with a pathway for harmonizing management and leadership. She says the transition from an individual performer or individual contributor, which a typical executive at the front line is, to manager who manages a group of people is a profound psychological adjustment, a transformation, because it is no longer necessary for a manager to do everything by himself. In fact, if he continues to do everything by himself, he can never be a manager. He will continue to be an individual performer. So the transition from individual contributor to a manager is one phase of transition. Then the process of becoming a leader from being a manager is a process of learning from experience. That is, you observe how management principles can be put in practice, how leaders are working their way up, and how leaders are influencing course transformations in organizations. This is a process of observation and experiencing the process of leadership. And together, through trial and error, observation and interpretation, the new managers can become effective leaders when they are able to perform in their jobs and when the opportunities emerge. The challenges of transformation in this: reframing to understand the new roles and responsibilities, rebuilding or even building new effective work relationships, how and when to use individual and organizational resources, and learning to cope with the inevitable stresses of the transformation. We have to again connect back to one of the earlier things which Marshall has said, that is, what got you here will not get you to the new state. Therefore, the challenges of transformation or adjusting yourself to the new reality and using resources in a manner that your footprint as manager or as a leader is very clearly visible to the entire organization. So new managers must learn how to lead others than do the work themselves. They should learn how to win trust and respect, how they can motivate and inspire people, and finally have the right balance between delegation and control. We learned in an earlier session about the too loose, too tight kind of situation. That is something which is to be avoided, and that's where transformation also counts. You know, one's own mindset. Amy Edmondson, she talks about organizational learning. She advocates the fearless organization. Millennials particularly will respond very openly to this hypothesis. People feel empowered these days to speak up and talk about the new ways of doing things. She says that an organizational culture which ensures psychological safety for people, that is, which empowers people without any retribution to speak up, it does three good things. One, it explores the link between psychological safety and high performance. So the higher the level of psychological safety you assure to the employees, the higher will be the individual as well as corporate performance. Secondly, if you are able to nurture the level of engagement and candor required in today's knowledge economy, it will be acting in virtuous synergy with psychological safety. If you ensure psychological safety, it will heighten the level of engagement and candid method of operation. And if you nurture the level of engagement and candid operations, psychological safety ipso facto will improve. That's the second point. And third, most importantly, the leadership make it very clear that it is safe to express ideas, ask questions, admit mistakes, and even make contrarian propositions if they are supposed to be good for the company. So when you have these kinds of people enablement processes through assurance of psychological safety, then a lot of innovation, creativity and spark will take place in the organization. You can actually feel in organizations and in the town halls when you walk in, the way people react with confidence and competence versus in certain other passive organizations where people remain mum and they would not like to speak up lest they should offend the leadership. So it is very important that organizational culture encourages fearlessness. Of course, the fearlessness should not be permissiveness. It should be disciplined. It should be bound by certain value systems, and it should also have some accountability. We have Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee. They talk about the new digital age. They talk about the bounty and spread which comes out of use of digital technologies, and they say that it goes beyond standard economic measures like GDP. They also talk about the digital divide, how digital integration is being threatened at the first place by the digital divide which is brought in by the digital technology. Today we are working from home. The education is happening through digital learning mode. But if you look at a country such as India or several other less developed countries, you will find that digital education is not accessible to a large percentage of student population in indigent parts of the country and also in rural areas. This has led to sharp digital divide. So how do we bridge this divide? So the more digital we become in certain pockets of the country, those islands of success would be there. But the key lies in moving away from digital divide and moving into digital integration. So how do you do that? For that, we should weave in micro and macroeconomics with insights from other disciplines so that we understand how certain core industries such as telecommunications, certain infrastructural industries can be developed. If we are able to work from home seamlessly in the face of COVID pandemic, it is because we have had strong telecommunication backbone. So certain industrial infrastructural activities are essential to enable that the country becomes one connected country and the world becomes one connected world. So the new digital age requires investments in certain key infrastructural areas, including telecommunications, computers, information technology, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and things like that. And they cannot be pockets for use by only certain industrial segments or population segments. Another management thought leader is Francisca, you know, she talked about rebel talent. She says that rebel talent has got five elements. One, novelty. Rebel talent always seeks something new. They are willing to express a new way of doing things, seeking out a new way of challenging the status quo. They also have got a lot of curiosity, the impulse to ask why. Why should we do it the same way? They also have the perspective to broaden their view. They are willing to accept your views, the established views, provided they make sense or if they are logical. But they are also asking you to broaden your own view to a worldview as others see. Then the rebel talent also encourages diversity, gender diversity as well as intellectual diversity. It looks at predetermined social roles as constraints and tries to challenge them and tries to create new roles. And it also looks for authenticity, where openness, transparency is there in day-to-day relationships, in working relationships. It also accepts vulnerability as a natural phenomenon of human behavior at work. So rebels may have a negative reputation, but they have the capability and they are the ones to change the world for the better with their unconventional outlooks, allowing businesses to evolve and prosper. So when Elon Musk came up with his electric car initiative, he was maverick in his approach to electrification. But he was far ahead of the requirement as thought by established automobile manufacturing companies at that time. But with his singular rebellious approach towards transforming an automobile industry which is based on IC engines into electric automobiles, he has charted out a totally new way of saving the planet from the pollution of automobiles. So the rebel talent which is inherent in such intellectual people helps companies to seek newer avenues of growth. So it is very important to encourage rebel talent. Nirmalya Kumar, he is another master theorist who worked at INSEAD, Emerging Markets Institute. He has moved from being marketing tactician to marketing strategist as part of his hypothesis. He says that marketing is no longer one functional strategy. He says that marketing itself is strategy. He says that we should not look at segments of market as marketing segments. You should look at strategic segments because you are not providing just products to those segments. You are providing solutions for customers. You are looking at distribution channels as not just some intermediaries. You are wanting them to grow into their own businesses because they have the customer connectivity between the firm and the product and the customer. Because dealers have the connectivity between the firm through the product and service to the customer. And that experience of utilizing the product, getting it serviced, could itself be an experience business for the customer. So we should not look at distribution channels as something which need to be de-emphasized. In fact, we should try to grow them into their own businesses. For example, Ashok Leland has done great things in having what it calls solutions business, which comprises Lekart, Service Mandi, providing GPS systems to drivers, iAlert, various digital solutions so that the operator experiences a better way of running a truck or bus, and similarly a faster way of keeping the truck on the move, minimizing the downtime. So there is a solution business that could happen through dealerships. Similarly, from branded bulldozers to global distribution partners, you should not be seen as one brand which has got such brand value that I don't need anybody. Instead of that, you should rely on regional partners to make your brands even more effective. And there's no point in just acquiring brands without seeing whether the brands are cannibalizing amongst themselves, the established brands versus the new brands. Rather, you should look at brand rationalization, by which you cover the entire market spectrum strategically. And instead of being market driven, drive the market, which is again the blue ocean strategy, which is finding out an uncontested market space so that you create your own product and your own market. And look at corporate marketing. Don't rest that you have created SBUs, strategic business units, which are having their own P&L responsibility and they are having their own cute product market segments. You should take a total corporate view of everything, including the SBUs, so that marketing becomes strategy. The key to success of market driving firms, according to him, is that they create and deliver a leap in benefits while reducing the sacrifices and compromises that customers have to make to receive those benefits. So it is an advantage to the customers and advantage to the firms. So as we go through these kinds of thoughts, you will find that some of the thoughts are pretty interlinked, like developing a new market space, driving market, which is pronounced by Nirmal Kumar, and the blue ocean strategy, creating the uncontested market space. We need to understand so many thoughts which are existing and which should be developed in management and leadership literature as well as in practice, so that you are able to connect those dots and use the appropriate models for our contextual situation. I'll explain why. Although several thoughts are being processed and presented, and again you are being asked to process all of them, you please realize that the brain has enormous ability to process huge amount of data. Probably you will be able to process even 1850 slides. 1850 is a huge number for any course. You may think that lots of inputs are being provided, but I assure you that all of you are intellectually capable to be able to assimilate all of these things, distill some of the very important points for your own contextual business situation or organizational situation and adapt. Who knows to which other situation you will migrate in future. You will be able to cross-fertilize, cross-pollinate and adapt some of these thoughts as you go into new year situation. Therefore, what we want to learn must always have a very wide canvas, even if what we apply in the immediate context is somewhat limited. Anyway, let's move on with the thought leaders. Gary Pisano is another thought leader who talked about the cultural framework necessary for big firms to innovate. He says that if you have risk taking in an organization, you have creative exploration, rapid learning, ability to think differently and experimentation, a big firm will be able to innovate. But he says big firms typically lack these things. They are so procedure bound, they are so profitability, viability, model bound that they refuse to take risks. They are so much comfortable with their own paths of development, they are not willing to creatively explore new paths. They are happy with their successes, therefore they are not agile in learning new things. That's why many corporations have startups to help them in newer areas of development and growth, more particularly in research and development areas. They would like to think more efficiently in their ways of thinking rather than think differently. And they are not willing to experiment far too much. They don't run too many pilot projects. So these big organizations' cultural traits, which are based on execution, reliability, predictability, certainty, he says, must be replaced by this five-point cultural framework, which allows risk-taking, creative exploration, rapid learning, different thinking, and experimentation. To be able to do that, he proposes a four-cell matrix, wherein one can appreciate the threat, whether it is distant or imminent on one axis, and the relative impact of switching through the innovation, whether it erodes profitability or enhances it. It is not a quantitative tool necessarily, but it tells you the mapping of risk and creativity as you look at different options to build for the future, while maintaining, of course, the core business. Charles Handy is another important leader. In fact, when Harvard Business Review wanted a fifth anniversary special issue to be embellished by notable contributions, they called upon Handy, Drucker, and Mintzberg for special articles. So he is on the same platform as Peter Drucker and Henry Mintzberg in terms of creativity and contribution to management thought. He looks at three forms of organization. One form of organization is in terms of power. How decentralized is your power structure? How shared is your power structure? And how individualized or personalized is your power structure? And that comes with the federal approach in an organization. The more federal an organization is, the more it would be in terms of decentralizing the power structure, sharing it, and personalizing it. We would also need to look at how innovative the organization is. Just as federal organization is one type, innovative organization is another type. The triple I factor, intelligence, information, and ideas, they must form the bedrock of the innovative type of organization. And the shamrock, the bedrock of an organization, is how do we promote a loyal career? How do you ensure that the ones who are in contractual fringe, that is, who are existing only for the paycheck, are not the ones who are going to influence the organization? Neither are those people who are being outsourced, but those people who are willing to join the company, to work and run with the company on its growth path, those are the people who need to be encouraged. And he says that if you have three P's, purpose, pattern, and people, it would be the heart and meaning of life and the keys to contribution in an organization. He talks about creating a portfolio of life and a themed collection of work experience and life experience, which will be inspiring not only for people who have coasted through these life journeys in the organizations, but also stand out as role models for others to emulate. In one of the transformational models that would come up later, I would talk about how there is nothing like silence for a leader. A leader continues to be a leader, and with the stature increasing all the time, a leader will be able to communicate a lot more than what the title would suggest. So we need to have role models in organizations who ensure that power mechanisms, intellectual, innovative mechanisms, and the career mechanisms are all in synchronization with each other. Jeff Pepper and Gerald Salins, they talk about organizational power. They talk about resource dependence theory. Dependence, independence, interdependence. These are the classic dilemmas of group dynamics and organizational design. How dependent we should be and how independent we should be as functions, as individuals, as leaders. And what is the level of interdependence we must encourage through organizational structures and process. The solution to this could vary from firm to firm and from industry to industry. If it is a startup, the dependence independence is very high. The interdependence of a close-knit team is very well shown in a startup situation. But in an established organization, it must be probably more systemic and systematized. So the resource dependence varies based on the type of the company, type of the industry, and the stage of the firm. So, however, if you ensure an appropriate organizational effectiveness mechanism, an organizational environment, and understand the constraints, you will know how to balance out these factors. So these are environmental factors which tell us how dependent and independent we are amongst each other, so that organizations can take structures and processes that will respond properly both for internal forces and for external opportunities. As I said, not much is learnt about the Japanese management philosophies. We have got the solid Toyota production system, which has been documented by Ono-san and Shingo-san. We also have Imai-san talking about Gemba Kaizen. We have here Nonaka-san and Takeuchi-san talk about the Japanese business practices. They have written a book called The Knowledge Creating Company. They say how Japanese companies change the dynamics of innovations by creating new innovation dynamics all the time. They differentiate between explicit knowledge and tacit knowledge. Explicit knowledge is something which is written down in standard operating procedures, in designs and drawings, systems and procedures. They say that this method of knowledge creation is typically followed by the US managers. The system of tacit knowledge, which is learning through experience, communicating only indirectly through metaphor and analogy, is followed more by Japanese managers. I have had the experience of interacting with Japanese collaborators for several years, and I can vouch that the Japanese way of management is subtle, it is experiential, it is deeply embedded in the person and the departmental procedures, and it comes very naturally to the persons and the roles, and it is somebody need not search the manual and procedure to do a few things. This tacit knowledge, which is institutionalized and also combined with their lifetime employment system, ensures that the companies embed and institutionalize knowledge, and knowledge gets created therefore in a cumulative way in the organization, and it has a snowballing effect in terms of growth drive. Howard Gardner, he talks about multiple intelligences. He says that it is not just the intellectual capability that is of substance in leadership development. He says that there is linguistic intelligence, your ability to master multiple languages, and that mastery has certain brain capabilities that let you view things in a different way. Our own Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao had the ability to be proficient in multiple languages. That has also given him the ability to look at things in a completely different way. Otherwise, he wouldn't have brought in, along with Dr. Manmohan Singh, the economic liberalization package so smoothly. So this is one example of linguistic proficiency and linguistic intelligence having some relationship with economic intelligence. Then we have got logical mathematical intelligence. You also have musical intelligence, the ability to coordinate the brain, the vocal cords, the expression, the kind of empathy and the feel of music with actual hand movements. Then you have got the spatial intelligence, ability to relate to whatever is happening. Let's say you are in a truck manufacturing company and you are looking at forgings, and you move to a two-wheeler company and you are looking at the same division, but there is a huge difference, maybe 100x, from a forging which is used in a truck versus a forging which is in two-wheeler. To be able to grasp this and the tolerances that are required to a tighter degree in a two-wheeler manufacturing company, you require some type of spatial intelligence. Similarly, the bodily kinesthetic intelligence, how you make robotics. Probably a person who is bodily intelligent could be a better robotics developer than one who looks at only drawings and abstract models. The interpersonal intelligence, intrapersonal intelligence, both of these we talked about as emotional intelligence. The naturalistic intelligence, the pedagogical intelligence, the existential intelligence. There are 10 different types of intelligences. Depending upon the types of intelligences we have, in what shades and what mixes, we have our own ways of processing information. And these ways of processing information are independent of each other. The inputs may be the same, the communication may be the same, but depending upon the types of intelligences we have, we process the same information in a different manner. So he comes up therefore with a critic of the standardized intelligence theory, which emphasizes a correlation between one number of intelligence quotient with performance on the job. He says that we should assess our own team and ourselves in terms of the multiple intelligences which are natural to us and which we are capable of. And the more we develop ourselves on all of these intelligences, the more we'll be able to be effective, efficient and creative. Git Hofstede, he talked about the pioneering research on cross-cultural groups and organizations. He proposed a systematic framework for having the best possible cultures in organizations, and he said culture is the software of mind, and he says that intercultural cooperation is extremely important, critical for survival, I would say, and also growth of organizations. The framework which he suggests has got these following six elements: the power distance, masculinity of thought versus femininity of thoughts. It doesn't mean that femininity of thought is a weaker thought or masculinity of thought is a higher thought. In fact, we have several examples which say that femininity of thought provides better results and is more assertive and more value-based, and organizations benefit from a mix, good mix, positive mix of masculinity of thought as well as femininity of thought. He talks about individualism as a cultural anchor, our willingness to or our propensity to avoid uncertainty, our strategic orientation, the long-term orientation, and our ability to be restrained versus our ability to be boisterous and indulgence. These are all certain cultural anchors which are extremely important to develop a positive cultural environment in an organization. He proposed that national and regional factors contribute to the culture of the organization, and eventually they influence the behavior of employees in the organization. In a later course module, I will also talk about the cultural anchors which organizations could have and how the culture of an organization is extremely important for organizations to be differentiated. Again, I would loop back to the ESG concept. Only a positively culturally anchored company can be adept at ESG leadership. So culture as the software of the organizational mind is extremely important. So with this, we come more or less to the end of this first session. Just to recap, we have done many things during this first week. We have set the business context for the leadership, and to do so, we talked about the firm in terms of its basic architecture, in terms of its globalized architecture. We talked about production-production interface, marketing firm interface. We talked about industry business interface. We also talked in the subsequent session on management and leadership. We tried to delineate, and we also tried to find the similarities between management and leadership, and we said that both need each other and they are mutually reinforcing to each other. We also brought out the concept of administration being an extremely important as third anchor of the whole developmental paradigm. Management, leadership and administration, each with a purpose and perspective, is important for developing growth. Then we came to three parts of management thought. We tried to cover nearly 100 leading management thinkers from the early generations of Gilberts and Taylors to the late mid generations of Douglas MacGregors, Peter Drucker, to the recent contemporary generations of Michael Porter and C.K. Prahlad. We covered almost every notable management thinker and tried to summarize and present for you not only their biographical sketches but also their leading contributions to the management thought. I could also present the book covers so that they make an visual impact on you and you would be kind of inclined to look at those selections at some times in future. So with this, we have got an overall perspective about management and leadership, which enables us to go to the next week and explore the management theories that are already established, try to relate them to our own course. So thank you very much for being ardent listeners in this course, and stay safe and take care. We'll meet again next week in lecture number 6. Thank you.